Yeah, thank you, Stanley. Good morning to our televiewers. Magandang umaga po sa inyo lahat.
Yes, magandang umaga rin. Now, President Ramos was truly special to you personally and even professionally. You wrote a book, now a memoir perhaps, Behind the Red Pen, My Adventures with FVR. Please tell us a bit about it, the title which perhaps encapsulates your entire experience with him.
Yeah, the title is actually based on the red pen that he's been using as a personal trademark. And so I wanted to let the people know who the person behind the red pen was. That's why I chose that title. And it's mostly about my recollection about his presidency, not much about the main events, but the stories behind the events. So andun yung mga what happened before the main event, how he was, how the circumstances were. So medyo may konting Marites.
Now, Mr. Terencio, were you there from the start of his presidency? Yeah. Jojo, were you with
there.
FVR at the beginning of the presidency? So you saw the transition.
Yes. Actually, I worked with the team of former President Cory Aquino for the last 8 or 9 months of her administration. And one thing good about the former president, the late President Ramos, was he didn't bring in much of his media team from the campaign. Mm-hmm. He utilized the existing manpower power at the press office. And I was one of the youngest then. I was 21 years old. And I'm glad that he took a chance on me. And for 6 years, I was his close-in reporter.
And I'm sure he didn't regret that. Jojo, the title speaks volumes about FVR, of course, as a visionary and as a leader. It not only describes him as a meticulous manager, but that he is pretty much hands-on through most of his affairs. Now, how may you see that as an asset in the presidency that he had held so and performed so admirably?
It's a very good plus point for him because he's been known for being meticulous leader, excellent visionary leader.
And right.
He brought that to the presidency. And one thing good about President Ramos, when he assumed the presidency in 1992, he had a vision. He wanted the Philippines to become a newly industrialized country when his term ends, supposedly in 1998. Well, Stanley, we almost had it. Pero nagkaroon ng 1997 Asian financial crisis, you recall. But thanks to the solid economic foundation at that time, we also recovered fast out of that crisis. So he knew what he wanted for the Philippines. He wanted us to attain the NIC or Nick Hood status at that time. He had a solid program through the Philippines 2000. I don't think you've heard about that.
Of course.
The Philippines 2000 program. Yeah.
I did.
Under that program, he initiated many bold policies, like, for example, dismantling the monopolies in the areas of aviation, telco, etc. He opened up the economy. He solved the energy crisis. And most of the most important projects that he initiated is the social reform agenda, which was meant to eradicate poverty at the time, or not at least reduce poverty incidence by, in 1992, I think it was more than 40%, to at least 30% when his term ended. And he pretty much succeeded on that. And now we're about 20% in 2020.
Right. Now, speaking of achievements, of course, Jojo, no? One of the highlights of his presidency was the rebranding of the Philippines from sick man of Asia to an economic tiger, especially in the 90s until 1997 during the financial crisis. Now, it's a feat considering that he's coming from the previous revolutionary government of the late President Corazon Aquino. Now, describe to us the kind of focus and vision that he exhibited to get all of these done within a standard presidential term, if I may add.
Yeah. When he assumed the presidency, he was a minority president. We only got like 23% of the vote. And so he needed to have a bigger mandate. And aside from reaching out to the grassroots, what he did was to build a rainbow coalition in Congress so that his legislative agenda would have no problems when he submits that to Congress. And he did. So it was a team effort. He would say that he involved the legislative branch, Congress, I mean, the House of Representatives, the Senate. And one thing I recall is that the meeting between the legislators and the executive, led by the president at that time, the LEDAC meeting was almost twice a month. He was really hands-on in seeing through that his pet deals are carried out, so that when there are some challenges about the bill or questions from the legislators, the congressman or the senators himself will be asking directly from him, so that by the end of the meeting, there would be a consensus and agreement. So that's one of the secrets then. And another factor in achieving that, being the economic tiger cub of Asia, there was really a private sector participation. And he was the country's number one salesman. So he would use every opportunity, even golf. So that's what he called golf diplomacy. He would invite state leaders to play with him when he's on state visits, or the business community who would want to play golf. So, you know, while playing golf, he would talk to them with business. So it's one of the styles of the president.
Yes, as you mentioned and as you described, it had been a very challenging time. He was a minority president. He had to get the go of a lot of other parties forming, a lot of sectors and leaderships forming at that time. Well, FVR was a decorated soldier as well. He was a top-notch military leader and a president that has conquered gargantuan tasks, perhaps, of steering the country to heights during his time. He was also associated with a regime considered the darkest time in Philippine history. I mean, did he struggle with that? What feelings, perhaps, or thoughts about this did he share with you?
He admitted that he was, of course, it was already recorded in history that he was part of that phase in our history. But I guess he liberated himself out of that by being one of the heroes of the EDSA Revolution and standing by former President Corazon Aquino during the seven coup attempts that she had under her administration. So even though it was less in words, there were no categorical statement from the former president about if ever he regretted that or something. He did it by action. He defended democracy. He respected constitutional processes. Walang mga pinakulong na mga media. Wala siyang binan sa palasyo. Wala siyang pinasarang mga newspapers. Walang ad boycott. So for that alone, I guess it speaks more than any word can describe this.
Okay, now Jojo, to quote from the book, FVR, of course, enlikens the Philippines to a sinking ship with many leaks caused by internal strife and disunity. The president, as our captain, must be mindful of where the leaks are coming from and act on it immediately, or act on them immediately. What thoughts did he share with you regarding the succeeding presidents, perhaps, in the way that they have dealt with these challenges after his term?
That was the last interview that he granted before he retired from, you know, politics. And we were talking about not only at that time it was President Duterte, but the previous presidents, or the president succeeding him. And I was asking him, Mr. President, what can you say about your, you know, successors, including the present one whom you supported in 2016? Did you have any regret? He didn't answer it directly, but he said he admitted that there were a lot of issues at the time and even now. And he said future president must be a unifying president, not only in words but by actions. And the people also must do their part as citizens. So the sinking ship, meaning the country, kung lulubog ang bangkang yan, sama-sama rin naman tayo. So we might as well help the present government, whoever the president is. May mga regrets, but yeah.
Yeah, were there moments in your conversation perhaps that you would catch him saying, if I were the president, I would do it this way and that way and not that way?
Ang sinabi lang ni President Ramos noon, tinanong ko kasi, I asked him, sir, if you were the president, do you think we would have achieved your vision of we are now a newly industrialized country or one of the richer countries in Asia? And he said yes. And okay, so what was your timeline if ever had your you were given another term? He said in 10 years time I would have made it. We would have made it. But then again, that didn't happen, of course.
Okay. Now, Jojo, you have worked with President Ramos on and off from his presidency to the near present time. FVR has, of course, his signature thumbs up to show emphatically his approval on any matter. Now, as a young professional working for and with him, how hard was it to get the coveted thumbs up? Because in the book, you spoke about CSW. A reporter a while ago mentioned he has had CSW even in his final burial arrangements. Now, this was a grueling process, completed staff work required of everyone on every report, every proposal or project. Please describe to us the dynamics of this demand from the president.
It was a practice that he's been using since his military days, and he brought that to Malacanang. Perhaps it's one of his best legacies in terms of administrative processes in the executive branch. The CSW concept was that the background of that, why he even held a summit or a workshop for that with the presidential management staff and all the cabinet members at that time and their staff, explaining the process step by step. So what he really wanted is that any, for example, any project or any contract that must reach his office on his table must have undergone thorough processing, evaluation, endorsement of the person in authority, like, for example, the cabinet in charge. Mm. And then when he looked for other details, it must be supported. It must be in that briefing paper. So that when the document comes on his table, he would either approve it or disapprove it. So nalilessen yung process. Hindi katulad ng iba ngayon na pabalik-balik because it's lacking in some information or some documents. Yes.
Parang it's doing your homework for short, no?
Yes, oo. Parang boss mo naman, Presidente, mahiya ka naman mag-submit ng sloppy work, di ba? So parang ang sinasabi niya lagi nun sa cabinet or sa amin, if you were the president and you were given this kind of document, how would you feel?
Okay.
Di ba? Kung if you think it's mediocre, don't even submit it to me.
Okay. Now, Jojo, the FVR definitely influenced you professionally, even on a personal level, perhaps, having shaped you to what you have become through the years. What were the most valuable lessons that you have learned from him that you have carried through your engagement beyond the Ramos years?
I guess one is in terms of human relations, because the former president is very a master of human relations, meaning he's real. He does not exclude anyone. His was an inclusive presidency. Mm. So wala siyang ini-alienate na tao. Like for example, one event, he was coming out of an event and then there were rallies, the secretary, the PSCs were protecting him, and yet he decided to go straight to the rallies, ask for the person, the spokesperson of that group, and he held an impromptu dialogue. So I guess that's one thing that was embedded in me, that in any case you shouldn't be excluding anyone, especially in terms of decision, because no one has the monopoly of knowledge.
Okay. Now, Jojo, you're paying your last respects to the former president. We'll be laid to rest today. Kindly walk us through what to expect today from your end. Where are you right now?
Right now, I'm here at the Heritage Chapel. It's only the family here and some of those who will assist later in the formal ceremonies. At this moment, I think they are preparing the urn to be transferred to the casket. Mm-hmm. And after that, at 9 o'clock, there will be a mass. But I guess it's not only a Catholic service, but being a Protestant, there will be a pastor and there will be an imam. So it's going to be an ecumenical service. And that's, again, that shows how inclusive the president is, including in all religions. So after the service, it would be a family time until 10 a.m. And then the departure honors from Heritage to Libingan starts at 10.
Okay, now about the book, The Man Behind the Red Pen. For those interested to read the memoir, how do they get their hands on the book? Perhaps is it available online?
It's available at popular bookstore in Quezon City, Solidaridad in Manila, and they can go to the Facebook page of Behind the Red Pen. There's an online seller, so it's easy to procure. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks a lot for joining us, Mr. Jojo Terencio, author behind The Red Pen. Thanks a lot for your insights and what you've shared with us this morning.
Thank you, Stanley. Good morning. Thank you.
Thank you.